Children's Church at this time. Take your Bibles, let's turn together to the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 7, Revelation chapter 7. If this is the first time that you've been with us, I will let you know that you can always go online. You go to our website, you'll find the past parts of our series are located there. We have been going through the book of Revelation, going back to school on Revelation, kind of a play on words there with school starting back up. Today we're going to be talking in chapter 7 about being signed, sealed, and delivered. Revelation, as I've tried to teach you, is primarily about Jesus Christ. It is the revelation of Christ. And so everything that we study in Revelation somehow should reflect on Him and on His kingdom. One of the problems in putting together a timeline for Revelation, which is what everybody wants to do, is that we misunderstand things when we come to it. We as in a Western mindset, we think that 1, 2, 3 is followed by what number? 1, 2, 3 is followed by 4. It's sequentially in that way. When it comes to Revelation, we assume that because chapter 5 precedes chapter 6 and chapter 6 precedes chapter 7, that the events described have to take place in that particular order. But the reality is, what he describes is, and then I saw. So it is the progression of the vision that takes place, not necessarily the progression of the events. And so that leads us to understand that some of these events may actually overlap. They may be the same or different descriptions of the same kind of event. You don't have to agree with me. Just nod your head this way if you at least hear what I'm saying to you. What I'm doing is I'm kind of going against the timeline thing because I think that there are some better lessons, there's some better truths and principles that we can discern as we look at this passage. And one of the things that we can discern from chapter 7 is that we want to be among those that are signed, sealed, and delivered. That's who we want to be. We want to be in that group of people. Because ultimately, God's purpose is not to bring judgment. God's purpose is to bring salvation. Now, let me say that again because it's really important. You kind of got to wrap your mind around this piece in order to really understand chapter 7. God's purpose and intent in all of Scripture is not to get us to a place of judgment, not to bring us to judgment. God's intent, His purpose, is to bring us to salvation. Scripture is clear. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God's purpose in it all is to bring us to a point of salvation. So we've got to understand that in order to truly grasp what's going on in chapter 7. Now, chapter 7 tends to be a bit controversial, a lot of debate, because it mentions the 144,000. How many have heard about the 144,000 before? And so there are a lot of different ways to look at it. Some groups in our culture and our society say that the 144,000 were actually alive in 1927, and that if you weren't born by 1927, you're not going to be part of the 144,000. That's a particular group that exists in our culture today, and they have their kingdom halls located in different places. That's one way to look at it. Some people think that the 144,000 is a literal number, talking about the number of Jews that will end up being saved, those that are of the tribe of Israel that will end up being saved. And then others, like myself, we see 144,000 as being symbolic. It's 12 times 12, or it's 12,000 times 12,000, 12 being the number of completion. And so it's not about the martyrs that died during the tribulation period. It's not about Israel getting a second chance. To me, it makes up the kingdom of God, all the people of every generation. It's an innumerable amount, and we're going to see that in chapter 7 as well. But the point of the whole thing is that I want to be among those that have experienced the sign of God's mercy, that have been sealed by His presence and His Holy Spirit, and that is truly delivered from the things that surround me. I think the message today is going to get in your business. So you better buckle up and you better hang on because I'm going to get in your face today. So look at the person on your right and the person on your left and tell them, buckle your seatbelt, we're ready to go. Revelation chapter 7, beginning in verse 1. So now I've warned you, now is the time to get up and leave if you don't want me to get in your business. Okay? I'm assuming since everybody's still in their seats that we're supposed to go on with this. Hold your Bibles up when you found Revelation 7. All right, listen to what the Word of God says. After these things, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, on the sea, or on any tree. Now, if you remember back in chapter 6, we started opening the scrolls. The seals were being opened up. And now as the seals are opened, this angel is doing something. Verse 2. Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried out with a loud voice to the four angels whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees until we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. Now, a lot of people get bogged down trying to figure out what the sealing on the forehead is. We're not going to worry about that. I would suggest to you it's probably a reference to the sealing of the Holy Spirit upon believers. But we're not going to worry about that. People contrast that to the 666 and the tattoos and all kinds of things that we allude to. But we're not going to worry about that issue. Let's keep going. See what else is going on. And then I heard a number of those who were sealed. 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. Of the tribe of Judah, there were 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Reuben, there were 12,000 sealed. Of the tribe of Gad, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Asher, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Simeon, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Levi, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Issachar, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Zebulun, there were 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Joseph, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000 were sealed. Oh my goodness, what is going on in that passage? Doesn't that seem to be redundant in some ways? Couldn't they just say to the tribes of Israel, all these people were sealed? Well, there's a reason. I don't believe God wastes words. We're going to come back and talk about it. What I will tell you is this. That is a non-traditional listing of the tribes of Israel. This is the only place that you find this kind of listing is in Revelation. You got to understand that in order to understand what's being said. That's why I do not believe this is literally speaking about the children of Israel. The Apostle Paul said, not everyone who claims to be Israel is. In the same way, not everyone who claims to be a Christian is a Christian. I mean, if your cat has kittens in the refrigerator, it doesn't make them biscuits. That's where we keep our biscuits, in the refrigerator, right? Just because you're in church on Sunday doesn't mean you're a Christian. Just because a nation, a people is called Israel doesn't mean they are true Israel. True Israel is the people of God. Let's keep going. We got a little more to read. Verse 9. After these things, I looked and behold a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues, standing before the throne, before the Lamb, clothed with their white robes, with palm branches in their hands, crying out with a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. All the angels stood around the throne and the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and they worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders answered me, saying to me, who are these who are arrayed in white robes and where did they come from? And I said to him, sir, you know. And he said to me, these are the ones who have come out of the great tribulation. They've washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore they are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them. And they will neither hunger anymore nor thirst anymore, and the sun shall not strike them nor any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of waters. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. What a powerful ending to that passage. And what a powerful passage. I want you to think with me for just a minute about signed, sealed, and delivered. First thing I want you to understand is the sign is a sign of God's mercy. The sign that we see in this passage is a sign of God's mercy. We often think of the book of Revelation in terms of judgment. And judgment is a part of it. And judgment is, in fact, coming. But the seals that have been opened in chapter 6, that something is truly being held back when we get to chapter 7. We're introduced to an angel who comes and says, don't kill anybody, don't harm anybody, don't blow quite so hard, don't let the devastation and the destruction fully come. The true judgment's not going to appear till we get to chapter 9. But here in chapter 7, we see a sign of God's mercy in that he's withholding some of the judgment and not allowing something to happen. Here's how I interpret that. What I begin to understand is this. No matter how bad it looks around us, it can always be worse. We live in a culture where everybody's crying out how bad things are. I'm here to tell you, it could always be worse. If it were not for God's grace and God's mercy, it would be worse. There was a terrible earthquake in northern Haiti. Bernie and Nancy Miller getting ready to go on another mission trip down to Haiti. There was an earthquake just yesterday there. I got to tell you, as bad as the earthquake was, it could have been worse. The devastation and the destruction of the hurricanes that hit the East Coast. The incivility that we experience in our own culture and society today. I've got news for you. As bad as it is, God is withholding some things. It could be so much worse. The most impoverished nations on the earth, were it not for the grace of God, it could still be worse. The most blessed nation on the face of the earth, this one, the one that you and I have the privilege of existing in, I got news for you. It could be lots worse. It could be worse. What we're experiencing is the sign. It is the sign of God's mercy. It is the sign of God's patience. It is the sign of God's grace. I said it a while ago, God's intent is not just to bring judgment. God's intent is to bring salvation. God seeks to save humanity. He sent His Son. He was so serious about it, to die on the cross. He took my punishment and yours because He loves us so much. It is a sign of God's mercy. Listen, I don't know about you. I want to abide under the sign of God's mercy. I want God's mercy to extend toward me, toward my life. I want to understand and be thankful for what I have and what I experience because were it not for the merciful hand of God, it could be worse. Isn't it amazing? We live in a culture and a society, everybody's sitting on pins and needles. Are the Chiefs going to win today? There will be people that will curse their television sets and they will throw their beer across the room and they will get all kinds of upset if the Chiefs happen to lose. But I got news for you. The Chiefs losing is not the worst thing in the world that can happen. There are worse things were it not for the mercy and the grace of God. Could be worse than it is. Second thing we discover, not only do we see the sign as being God's mercy, the second thing we discover is the seal. They are God's people. Notice what it says in this passage, verses 4 and 5. And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. Of the tribes of Judah, there were 12,000 sealed. And it goes through that big long list. And I told you earlier that that's a non-traditional listing. And what you have to do when you look at that is you have to try to figure out who's included and who's excluded. Because that makes a difference. That's why I know that it's not the traditional Israel. It's not the geopolitical entity Israel. Israel doesn't get a second chance. This is talking about the people of God. Because you know who's included? Joseph is included. The tribe of Joseph. Joseph never had a tribe. The Levites are included. Levi never had a tribe. The Levites were the priestly cult, and they were not given any property, no land in the promised land. And Joseph was not given any land. He was the one that was taken away to the palace. You see, who's included is important because included was the priest and the palace. If you go back to chapter 5 of Revelation, it tells us that the Lamb has transformed us. And you know what He transformed us into? A kingdom of priests and kings. Boy, don't you love it when it all fits together? You see, who's included? They are of the priesthood and they are of the palace. You see, Joseph was not given land in the promised land. His two sons were, that were born in Egypt. His two foreign sons were given property. But here in this reading, the ones that are included are of the priesthood and of the palace. And those that are excluded, Dan and Ephraim, those who reject God and those who reject God's anointed. I've given you the passages so you can go back and you can study. You see, the kingdom had been divided. The kingdom of Israel in the book of Kings had been divided into a northern and a southern kingdom. And there was a king that was set up and established in the southern kingdom, one of Solomon's offspring. Jeroboam went up into the northern kingdom, and he decided that he could not allow his people to go to the south, because if they went to the south to make sacrifice, this is what they would do. They would transfer their allegiance to the other side. He would lose his political clout. Oh, I know we don't see anything like that today. The Democrats are all afraid that the Republicans are going to take over. The Republicans are all afraid the Democrats are going to take over. And so we fight back and forth, and we bicker back and forth, and we argue back and forth. And in the process, what we do is we reject God. And we reject God's anointed. What Jeroboam did is he established idols in the northern kingdom. And he told his people, don't go down to Jerusalem to the temple and don't make sacrifice. You make sacrifice to these golden calves. And so in that process, they are rejecting God. And then they reject the God anointed king. Do you see a pattern here? You see, the ones that are included are those who become a kingdom of priests and kings unto God. And those who are rejected are the ones who reject God and who reject the anointed of God, who is Jesus. Those that are sealed are those who have come to God through Jesus Christ. Those who have been covered by the blood. Those that have been marked out as being God's people. Let me put it to you this way. One of these days, God is going to call out His people. One of these days, He's going to call His people out of the Democratic Party. One of these days, He's going to call His people out of the Republican Party. One of these days, He will call His people out of First Baptist Church of Odessa. The ones He's calling out are the ones that are under the sign of His mercy and the ones that are sealed because they have trusted God and believed His anointed. Nod your head this way if you understand. I'm talking serious. I'm talking serious business here. I want to be among those that are under the sign of God's mercy and those that are sealed. I want to be one of God's people. I want to be a man of the priesthood and the palace. I don't want to be one that rejects God and God's anointed. And then we come to number three and we discover the delivered. Signed, sealed, and delivered. Notice what it says. After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number, of all nations and tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes with palm branches in their hands. That word nation is an interesting word in the Greek. It's the Greek word ethnos. You might want to write this down. E-T-H-N-O-S. Ethnos. We have made that word in the translations of your Bible to mean a nation. But we also have taken that Greek word and we've transformed it into ethnics. It's talking about ethnic groups. Now let me help you here. Let me help you understand something. Those who are delivered by the blood of Christ. They're not delivered by shedding their blood in martyrdom. They're not delivered because they do certain things or they're good people. They're delivered because they are under the blood of Jesus. But I have to tell you, only the blood of Christ can destroy the things that separate us from each other. Notice what it says in this passage. It says that from every nation and every tongue and every tribe and every people, there are going to be people there. Listen to me. Democrats, you better start loving Republicans. Because if you're a follower of Jesus Christ and you end up in heaven, there's going to be some Republicans up there, and you're going to have to love them. And Republicans, don't smirk. You better start loving Democrats. Because one of these days, there will be a calling out of God's people, and you will be experiencing eternity with them. White people, you better start loving black people. Black people, you better start loving white people. You see, it is the transforming power of the blood of Jesus that transforms our lives and breaks down the barriers that separate us. It is the transforming power of Christ that enables this multitude that is innumerable from every people, every nation, every tribe, every tongue to be a part of God's kingdom. I saw a thing just the other day where a woman was yelling at some people in a store because the other people were speaking Spanish. I don't care if you speak English. You better start loving them. You speak Portuguese. Wasn't talking Portuguese. But we got to love them too. Do you understand? Listen, 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 listen. You cannot legislate the healing of our nation. I don't care who you put on the Supreme Court. I don't care who you elect for president. I don't care who you put in Congress or the Senate. That will not change the tide. Only Jesus Christ can change the tide. Can you imagine if those who claim to be followers of Christ, if we simply let Him transform our lives so that Democratic believers love Republican believers, and Republican believers love Democratic believers. Oh, I'll include you independents too, because we're all sitting there going, I'm an independent. You can get in. Kingdom is for everybody. Listen, our prejudice has to die. This is from a guy who had a South Arise Again bumper sticker on the back of his pickup truck in Tennessee. I can't believe that I ever would think for a moment that any race, God could view one race as superior to any other. God has to transform hearts and lives. I told you, it's going to get in your business. God's people got to love others. We got to love Him. Because guess what? I'm going to spend eternity with a lot of people who aren't my color. A lot of people who don't speak my language today. And a lot of people who didn't vote my way. And a lot of people who don't think about some things the way I think about some things. But guess what? If it's the blood of Christ that makes the difference, they may just in fact be covered by the blood. They may be under the sign of God's mercy. They may be sealed for all eternity. They may be delivered. Just like me. Just like you. Oh, people. Don't wait for government to change things. When did the church transform eternity into a destination and not a relationship? When did we change it? We read Revelation and we read the Scriptures and we think it's all about getting us to heaven someday. That's destination. Here's Jesus' definition. John 17:3. This is eternal life. That they may know you, the one true God, and Jesus Christ whom you've sent. That's eternal life. Why are we waiting? Church, why are we waiting till we get there to start living kingdom life here? Why are we waiting? If we're under the sign of God's mercy, if we've been sealed and delivered, we need to live kingdom lives now on this earth. We need to be kingdom people now on this earth. Oh, I know. Society's bad. Remember what I said? Could be a lot worse. God's mercy says it could be a lot worse. Guess what? It will never get better unless people are signed, sealed, and it will never get better unless we are signed, sealed, and delivered. Notice the reach of that deliverance. All nations, all tribes, all peoples, all tongues. Notice the road to deliverance. It's the same for everyone. These are the ones who've come out of the great tribulation. They've washed their robes and they made them white, not in their own blood, but in the blood of the Lamb. Let me show you a distinction between some religions. Islamists would say that if you kill an infidel and you lose your life, you get an automatic end to heaven. So by the shedding of your own blood, you get in. Christianity, on the other hand, says your blood means nothing. How you die, when you die, means nothing. His death means everything. It is the shedding of His blood that changes things. What is the road to deliverance? It is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. It's not through the pastor. It's not through a church membership. It's not through the shedding of our own blood. It is through the person and sacrifice of Jesus. He bled. He died for me. So we see the road. The reach and the road to deliverance. And then lastly, we see the reward of deliverance. Number three. Notice what it says. He that sits on the throne will dwell among them. They will neither hunger anymore nor thirst anymore. The sun won't strike them or any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. That relationship with God. Notice what it says about it. It says that it's a close relationship. That He will dwell among us. So we know His presence. See, when we've been delivered, we know the presence of God. We know that our relationship with Him, that it's not about the destination, it's about the ongoing daily relationship. He dwells with me. Where I walk, He walks. I know not only His presence, I also know His provision. Notice what it says. It says, then they will have food that's given to them. All of their needs will be met by their Heavenly Father. And then it goes on and it says, they know His protection. The sun and the heat won't affect them anymore. They know His purpose for their lives. What is their purpose? Where do you get that? This is what it says. It says, and He will be their, the Lamb will be their shepherd and lead them to living waters. Here's my purpose, to be a sheep, to follow my shepherd. That's my purpose. Now, I got to tell you something. Everything that promises, the reward of deliverance, is everything that Adam and Eve lost in the garden. When Adam and Eve were in the garden before the fall, guess what? They knew the presence of God. They walked with Him in the cool of the day. They knew Him intimately. They walked with Him day by day by day. When we get to this place in heaven, when this is taking place, it says that God will dwell among us again. They knew His provision. He said, anything you want to eat, all you got to do is go get it except for these two trees. Remember? It was all provided. They knew His provision. This passage says that He's going to take care of their needs. He's going to take care of their hunger. They will hunger no more. And I think that's pretty good. I like to eat. They know not only His presence, His provision, they know His protection. None of the animals that Adam had to name ever attacked him. They knew God's protection. And now in this passage that we just read in Revelation, it says that the heat's not going to bother them. There won't be any heat stroke there from laboring, from the toil, from the work. Adam and Eve knew their purpose. They were to have dominion, to reign, to control. They were to be leaders on the earth. Now we find that our purpose is to be sheep following our shepherd. Oh my goodness. I don't know about you. I want to be among those that are under the sign of God's mercy. I want to be those that are sealed by His presence in their lives. I want to be one of those that are delivered to a brand new life. One that is free from all those things that separate me from Him and separate me from you. I want to know the reward of knowing Him personally. So how can I know Him personally? Three things. First, I've got to admit that I'm a sinner. I have to admit, I need a Savior. I need a shepherd. I need someone to guide me. I must admit that I have gone against God's way, against God's word, and against God's will. The Bible says that puts me in good category because all of us are sinners. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I guess it puts me in a bad category, not a good category. Sorry about the misspoke. We're in a bad place because we're all sinners desperately needing a Savior. Second thing, I've got to not only admit that I'm a sinner, I've got to believe that Jesus died for me. I've got to believe that He paid the penalty for my sins, that He paid for my life and my mess ups and my mistakes, that, that he went to the cross and that it was his blood that was shed that will make all the difference in my life. His blood will transform me. His blood will make me acceptable to be in the presence of God. And then lastly, I've got to commit myself to follow him. I have to make a commitment. I'm going to follow my shepherd. I'm going to let him lead me. I'm going to let him guide me. I'm going to become one of his sheep. You know why? Because he leads to living water. He leads to the fountain that I need. Listen, don't follow me because I can't lead you to the fountain of living water. My job is to point you to the one who can. And the one who can is Jesus Christ. This morning, are you under the sign of God's mercy? Have you been sealed by his presence in your life? Are you being delivered so that you can stand with him, walk with him, follow him? I want to be among the signed, sealed, and delivered. Let's bow together. Father.